Peace, family. Peace, family. Peace, family. Peace to you and yours. Peace to you and yours. Peace to you and yours. Let me know if you can hear me in the building. Let me know if you hear sound effects. Let me know if you hear these sound effects. I'm trying to make some motion happen in this sound effects ocean. We've been playing with this machine, trying to get things up and going.
Peace, family. Peace, family. Peace, family. Peace to you and yours. Peace to you and yours. Peace.
Yes, yes, yes. Ashe, ashe. Greetings. Peace, Nashawn. What's good, everybody? All right. We are in the building. Yes, sir. We are here. We are in the building. We are going to have a fire stream tonight. I'm bringing a good brother, Alkibalon, through. You feel me? And he's going to drop some information now. But anybody in the building who is a ticket holder for the lecture that we had scheduled for today, 3/22, we sent out emails and we let everybody know that that lecture actually has gotten rescheduled, okay? That lecture has gotten rescheduled and it is currently going to be on the 7th of April, all right? Things have heated up and we are going, we're pushing this event to be closer to the eclipse than where it is now, okay? We're pushing it to be closer to the eclipse, which will be on the 7th. So we sent out an email and we let everybody know what that's about. Tonight's class is going to be a masterclass and is going to be a live event that we'll be doing as a precursor. There is a lot going on in the news today, especially. Okay, today especially has been a very, very, very interesting day. Okay, I'll talk about some things, and when Alkibalon pulls up, he will build on some things as well, right? But today is a handful, I must say. Today is a handful. I woke up today and the hip-hop world is on fire, all right? The hip-hop world is currently on fire and it involves some of the biggest names in the game, okay? Rightfully so. So we now have a hip-hop war that has been ignited with some people's favorite artist, who is our good brother, Kendrick Lamar, all right? The good brother, Kendrick Lamar, is on them boys' necks. Pause. The good brother, Drake, and also J. Cole, all right? Shout out to Drake and J. Cole. Get your bars up and get in that lab, good brothers. There's nothing to talk about. You know what I'm talking about? There's nothing to talk about. And then, you know, that has everybody talking, and rightfully so. You know, hip hop is a competitive sport. And once again, like I said, with two artists of such a caliber, well, three artists for that matter of such a caliber, where these are global phenomenons and whatnot, it is definitely going to ruffle a lot of feathers, and it's going to make a lot of, you know, it's going to make a lot of noise. Okay, it's going to make a lot of noise. It's going to create a lot of ruckus. So that's what we're seeing right now in this space and whatnot. And, you know, who's to say what is going to come from this situation that we see taking place right now? What I can say without any, what's the word? Without any doubt, right? What I can say without any doubt, or without any type of, you know, holding back of things, is that it's going to create some good music, right? It's going to get the culture reset back to where it originally, you know, the whole 50th year of hip hop celebration, we were celebrating not just a culture, but an art form that's similar to a blood sport, right? Hip hop is all about competition, okay? It is not just, you know, reminiscent of the NBA and the NFL, right? Where there's stiff competition there, and it's all about, you know, getting that W and being at the top of your game and whatnot. Yeah, it has those components to it, but it also has another component to it, which is music, which is something that the quote unquote athletes don't participate in. This mystical, magical, you know, cultural expression of self and whatnot that is very, very powerful. Okay. The word, right? So what we know is that these brothers inside of the hip hop industry who are out here, you know, setting things off and whatnot, we know that it is going to create some good music. And that's when a lot of people have been saying that they were, quote unquote, doing without. A lot of people were in, you know, they were in lack. They were saying, yo, the culture is lacking. This shit is about, you know, these niggas is wearing fingernail polish and, you know what I mean? They were being very zesty and whatnot. And a lot of individuals were feeling like, you know, the culture let them down. Well, I'm here to let you know that 2024, once again, was promised to be a year of unexpected events. But this is a year of some pristine music. 2024 is almost reminiscent of 1994, okay? When there was a humongous wave of music that basically changed the trajectory of the industry. And that wave that I'm speaking about, they began to rise up in 1994 and crescendoed and really took off in 95 is what we call the bad boy era. The bad boy era is coming to a screeching, halting close in the year 2024. We're seeing the falling, the complete falling, not just of his quote unquote, this era or this epoch of Mr. P. Diddy, but everything that it was attached to as well is coming down. So by proxy, we would have to ask ourselves, is a Drake, right? Is a Aubrey and is a Drake connected to this quote unquote all about the Benjamins, P. Diddy, bad boys, take that, materialism over spirituality type of expression that he brought forth as a matrix, as an architect in this matrix, right? This materialism, this pop shit, this metrosexualism. Yes, that's exactly what Drake represents. To a T, almost frighteningly so, right? A fellow Scorpion, mind you, okay? Who, you know, he's embraced all of those motifs and what, you know, the bad boy or the shiny suit era would represent. I would definitely say, yeah, pin that tail on a donkey because that's him right there, okay? He promotes the zestiness, the zest fest. He promotes, you know, the fluidness, the metrosexuality of the quote unquote image of the black man or the amalgamated man and whatnot. He does represent an agenda. He is, by the way, half of a Zionist. We have to also, you know, add that in there. So he has two sides or two bosoms and whatnot. And it's been said that when his white side comes out, that people are turned off by him. And this has been the source of a lot of his fallouts, not to take any shots at anybody who has two nations in their bosom. I'm not in that race. You know, I don't have anything against our brothers and sisters of dual races and whatnot, but I'm definitely pointing that out. Okay. That's something that I'm highlighting. Okay. That the brother Drake, who to me represents, to be honest with you, when I see Drake, he represents the amalgamated more. He is the prototype and the archetype of the Moor, right, or the Morisco, who came and defeated their quote-unquote fathers during the capitulation of the Moors and whatnot. When the Moors fell, it was melanated men or amalgamated men, mostly from the wombs of European women, most importantly, Sephardic, right? Sephardic Jews, okay, which would qualify his mother, right? The Sephardic Jews, those women who you would find in places like Portugal, Spain, the Sephardic Jews with the curly hair, hooked noses, they're not necessarily blue blood Europeans and whatnot. These are Slavs, these are Nordics, these are Polacks and whatnot. His mama, okay? So the Moors had, they went up against their offspring, and their offspring slew them, okay? Their offspring slew them. The son will always take up, not always, but the son took up for the mother in that conflict. And the father was deemed to be non persona grata, right? Or persona non grata in that situation. And my son, the Mason, my son, which were the offspring of the Moors, from the loins of the Moors, they turned on the fathers and they beheaded the fathers. They ran them up out of Spain. They capitulated them. And then they took the show on the road. And they are the conquistadors. They're the ones who came over on the boats. They're the ones who invaded and whatnot. They're the ones who came up onto the land and they began to topple the quote-unquote, the empire, the Moorish empire, because when the Moorish empire fell in Spain, 1492, then what you see in history is really just the fallout. The fallout continues today. So Drake, DJ Khaled, I use them as examples. And who's a Dominican nigga? Because these were what you had. You got Drake, who's from Canada, right? He doesn't speak Spanish. He doesn't have a Spanish tongue and whatnot, right? However, look at his phenotype, okay? Look at his phenotype. And then if you put him next to a Dominican, right? The Dominican who has a Spanish tongue will basically fit his phenotype. If you just look at the phenotype, look at the phenotype, right? Look at the amalgamated Moor in his phenotype. He speaks with an English tongue because he's in Canada, right? But DJ Khaled, he may speak with an Arabic tongue because he's from Palestine, right? So in the Moorish kingdom, you had Berbers, you had Islamic bloodlines, you had Arabs and whatnot. They would represent like a DJ Khaled. But standing next to Drake, if nobody opens their mouth, they have similar quote-unquote phenotypes. And then you could get like a Dominican, right, from Dominican Republic and whatnot, like Poppy and them at the corner store in New York from the Bronx and whatnot. The dudes that you see at Yankee Stadium, the Dominicans, right? They have the Spanish tongue. You stand him next to Khaled. If he doesn't open his mouth, you could mistake Khaled for being a Dominican, or you could mistake the Dominican for being an Arab, most like a Yemenese, left from the Yemeni, right? Because they're the ones that got the stores in New York, and they have this quote-unquote phenotype that you saw in quote-unquote ancient Spain when we were mixing with the Arabs, and then you had the North Africans, and then the West Africans came in. The West Africans are the blue-black Africans, the Ghanaians, the ones from Ghana, the Somalians and whatnot, and other people from the Songhai Empire. Those were like the darker races, and they came in later on. That's the Almoravid dynasty. They come in to Europe or the Iberian Peninsula later on, right? And then they dispose of the old dynasty, which was completely amalgamated. They began getting very soft. They began to assimilate into this culture that was in Europe and whatnot. And they began to take on effeminate ways. And they basically began to get soft and whatnot. As a result of that, the Europeans, who were more war-hardened and whatnot, you're talking about the Ostrogoths, the Visigoths, these Germanic tribes and whatnot, like fucking Bigfoot, the Nordic, like Vikings and whatnot, they were able to begin to defeat the dynasty because the dynasty was getting soft. So the dynasty sent out an SOS, and they brought in like the Sufis. They brought in like the blue black, the Moors that was not playing. These niggas was, you know, they was about that work and whatnot. So they straightened everything up, but they didn't leave. They took over and whatnot. So as they take over, so they like, yo, we trying to bust some, you know, we out here, we ready to bust some cheeks and whatnot, because we over here and we around all of these Beckys and whatnot. We surrounded by Karens, Don and Karen and them. So they start busting up some cheeks and whatnot. So they have offspring. Their offspring becomes very powerful princes in different provinces, and they inherit castles and they inherit the riches, because remember, we pass inheritance through our scrotum. We pass royalty through our scrotum sacs, right? Through our progeny, meaning that when we let our nuts hang and whatnot, and wherever we have a child, that's where royalty is. I need you to understand how this shit works and whatnot. Wherever we step foot, I don't give a fuck where on God's green earth. The minute we get off the ship, if we smack bellies with a woman, that's why they would give us their daughters. That's why the chiefs would offer their offspring, because they want their daughters to catch that royal nut. Because as a result of that, when you caught that royal, when you was able to get chose by a royal, right? You now could become part of royalty by way of marriage and by way of bearing a royal, a child who in turn will become royal. Henceforth, if the man did not acknowledge the child, they were what? A bastard. And that goes on to these days, to this day, right? If he didn't acknowledge the child, the child is a bastard. Like, that ain't my child. Mama's maybe, papa's, mama's baby, papa's maybe. Maybe that's my child, but it don't look like me. This nigga has red hair. Like, what is that? You know, shit like that. You know what I'm saying? So wherever we went and spread our seed, that's where royalty is. Henceforth, why we're on seven corners of the, we're on the four corners of the earth across the seven seas and whatnot. And wherever we drop our nuts, that's where royalty is. So you find us in Hawaii, royalty. You find us in the Philippines, royalty. You find us in Russia, my nigga, royalty. You find us in South America, royalty. You find us in Africa, royalty. Because it's about the bloodline. It's about the blood. It's about the DNA. It's about the quote unquote stock. It's a specific stock. It's a specific pedigree. That's why we were not allowed to mix and mingle the way that people freely mix and mingle on Christian Mingle these days and whatnot. That's not what's up. We were not spreading our seeds like that. This was a science, animal husbandry. This was a science. You just wasn't slinging wood to anybody and anything. That's why they say you got to be equally yoked and whatnot. And that's a fact. I'm not making this up. That is what it is. The Moors fell to some light-skinned niggas. The tribes over here in Florida, right? When they were running through Florida and whatnot, and then they were running through Georgia, they were trying to penetrate Georgia and get to the gold and get to the resources and all of these things. Those is niggas. Those are amalgamated Moors. And then you had the brutish Moors, not the British Moors, the brutish Moors. They is looking like Idris Elba. You got to understand who you're dealing with. Everything is not black and white. That's where they lied to you. Everything is not black and white. They lied to us. They made us feel like, or they made us believe that this thing was a black and white thing. And to be honest with you, that term black and white, that is a new perspective. We were not running around identifying with colors and shit like that. Not like that. We were not doing that. That is a new concept. It's erroneous to a degree, right? And it is what is known as a social construct. Race is a social construct. It's not real. I don't give a fuck how good it feels. It's not real. It was about bloodlines. Who's your grandmama? They do that in LA, right? Man, fuck all of that. They like, who your grandma? And where does she stay? Right? They want to know bloodline. They want to know pedigree. They want to know stock. They don't care about all that other shit. That's for the birds and whatnot. Who's your grandmother? That's how you can measure man these days and what, not these days, but that's how man was measured. What is your last name, fam? That's how we'll know how to place you. What is your pedigree? What is your stock? So even when people run around talking about a white name and a slave master name, that's erroneous too. We got to change this conversation. We have to upgrade our lexicon, and we have to stop speaking from the vantage point of a victim, which is like a subservient slave. You can't occupy two spaces at once. So either you a king or you not, nigga. Either you royalty or you're not. Either you've been disposed from the throne or you're not, nigga. Like, you can't have it both ways. So if you identify yourself as a royal or a noble, then you won't have the kind of conversations that I see on on Black Inferior Twitter. You know, all of this woke rhetoric, you know what I'm talking about? All of this victimhood consciousness. And to be honest with you, it's not serving anyone in a positive way. It's not empowering anybody. All of these years of back and forth over this Trayvon Martin shit, all of the years of all of this other stuff, for what? When niggas is going to vote Trump next week. They're going to vote Trump. They're going to vote Trump and dare you to say something about it. You understand? They're gonna dare you to say something about it. Right? That's how they doing it. They're gonna dare you to say something about it. And a lot of people, they just like throwing their hands up. You know what? And I'm not to say that Trump has anything to do with Trayvon Martin, Mike Brown, and all of the brutality that was going on with the police and whatnot. But I'm here to say that he got everything to do with that. You know what I'm talking about? I'm here to say that until we figure out what the hell happened in the last some odd years, that we need to have a fucking seat and stop acting like we just could throw our allegiance behind some people that really don't serve us. I don't give a fuck how excited you get about Donald Trump and what he's gonna do to the Democrats and whatnot, and how he's supposed to free some kids that's trapped under Central Park. You niggas is wildin'. You know what I'm talking about? Y'all out to lunch and whatnot. And I don't identify with that weak shit that our people is running around with. They just jumping from one bandwagon to the next. It don't make no sense. And your talking points are fucking moot. And they're not even your talking points. You niggas pick them shits up from Candace Owens in Fox 5. That just comes from watching Fox for 4 years and being on Reddit and whatnot. Y'all are arguably echoing the sentiments of white supremacists and these think tanks and whatnot. They don't got shit to do with your monkey asses, bro. But nobody want to have no type of conversations whatsoever about how to boss up. When you start having those conversations, motherfuckers be like, well, what are you doing? And all of this other deflection and whatnot, rather than, you know, buckling down and getting to the getting to. Because there's a lot to get to. There's some great things going on in the world, but the shit don't involve Republicans and Democrats at all. That the minute you start talking about that shit, Like, you lost me, bro. I don't know what you're talking about. And today on 322, please give it up for the great divine speaking through signs. We don't make these things up. How the fuck do we know on 322 that Kendrick woke up choosing war and whatnot, and then World War III was gonna stop? Nigga, this is World War III, bro. This is World War III. This is a provocation for war in Russia. You gonna stop playing with Vladimir Putin? You know what I'm talking about? You gonna stop playing with Vladimir Putin and the Russians? Oh yeah, this is a declaration of war right here. They said the Islamic State group claims responsibility. Is that right? Is that right? If we know anything about these people who are called the Mossad and the CIA, oh, this is hallmark. This is what they do. You know what I'm talking about? This is what they do. This is what they do. They perfect shit like this. This is their calling card right here. Right? Mass shootings. Right? Mass shootings at a concert hall. They said at least 60 is dead. Okay? Right after Vladimir Putin is declared the president for another sixth term, I believe, a sixth term. And they penetrated Russia, right? This is not something that you've ever seen before. Okay? This is not something that you've ever seen before, right? Several gunmen burst into a concert hall on Friday and sprayed visitors with automatic gunfire and threw explosives, which triggered a massive blaze. You feel me? So what's the provocate? What's the get back gonna look like? What's the get back going to look like? In a statement posted by its news agency, the Islamic State group said it attacked a large gathering of Christians, killing and wounding hundreds, right? So these people are getting in their bags, right? These people are getting in their bags right now, okay? Once again, precursor to World War III, or rather a very interesting precursor to something that's coming up. Hold on. Another precursor to something that we've been talking about on this show. Right? And the good brother Blue Pill was so kind enough to come and lay it down, right? And he's been standing on top of his teachings and whatnot with the Mineral Ministries, Pope Pablo and whatnot. But what he really was giving you was this story about the three heifers, okay? He was giving you this information about the three heifers and whatnot. And come to find out that the three heifers is being, you know, has entered into the news stream. Okay. So let's go and visit his page and check out what's going on. It's so much going on. It's so much going on. And we got this eclipse coming and whatnot. We got this eclipse right on the horizon and whatnot. And they are moving their chess pieces like I've never seen before. Shit is moving for real, at a lightning pace. So you just saw October 7th when Israel declared that they were in a state of a war, right? So Vladimir Putin, right? As Aries is ushered in. Aries, the season of Aries is here. Aries is Mars. Aries is war, right? So here's Blue Pill's statement. I'm going to read it out loud. Shout out to Blue Pillar. You know what I'm talking about? Yes, you saw it on Alex Jones about the heifers. Yeah, them heifers is going up. They sending them heifers up. This is Aries season. Of course, Putin will finally declare war on the West. So Putin is declaring war on the West, right? The war has started, and the attack, the first attack was the one that you see today. This is Aries season. Of course, the Zionists are preparing the altar to sacrifice the red heifer while the Muslim world is observing Ramadan, sparking a holy war once they desecrate the Temple Mount. This is Aries season. So, of course, this Aries moon rising has been telling you this since October. Lost your YouTube page because of it, actually, right? We lost our YouTube page because we was advocating so fucking hard. This is Aries season. So, of course, they'll be disclosing that the U.S. has active troops in Taiwan at the same time the NVIDIA conference is taking place, right? Secure the chip by any means. This is Aries season. So, of course, the U.S. would declare war against the biggest company that's not NVIDIA. They finna take a bite out of Apple and shift the landscape. This is Aries seasons. Of course, Haiti will descend into such a chaotic state of turmoil that countries are going to beg the U.S. to intervene, and they're going to make the world pay them in blood. That's been the goal all along. This is Aries season. The Zionists are going to show you their fangs and hurl a final fuck you towards the rest of the world, recoiling from the horrors of what war really looks like. This is Aries season. Of course, Kendrick declares war on Cole and Drizzy. This is Aries season. And that eclipse means more blood, more war channeling that 44 energy. Heads or tails, the choice is yours. Okay? Let's get at a like. Right? So here we go. We can't make this shit up, but we definitely were prepping you for what the fuck you're seeing right now. Facts, okay? We were preparing you. So here it goes. It's here now. Russia's in a state of war, and Vladimir's not playing. Vladimir Putin is shooting, my niggas. Please don't sleep on that man. All right? So here we go. Breaking news. A massive sacrificial altar has been built in Jerusalem to sacrifice red heifers to usher in the third temple of Solomon. This sacrifice will take place between March and April, right? Shit, April's on the way. It is rumored that the Al-Aqsa Mosque has to be destroyed in order to build this temple. Many Christians fear this is similar to the prophecy of the end days in the Bible. I have been reporting on this since last spring. I will keep you updated. So the heifers is ready to go, okay? And if you don't know about the three heifers or the three red heifers and the sacrifice to usher in the third temple of Solomon, I would definitely encourage you to go and do the backlogs on our catalog. We've been covering this extensively, or it's a simple Google search because it's not hidden. It's not hidden at all. It's right in your face, and they're not hiding it. It's out in the open. It's real news. It's not fake news. Russia and China vetoed a U.S. resolution calling for immediate ceasefire in Gaza, okay? U.S. denies reports of troops on China's doorsteps, okay? So they're in Taiwan. Robots, do y'all hear any of these? I need my sound effects. Robots are entering, quote-unquote, battlefield. Now, who remembers when we was talking about robots entering into the battlefield? We was like, look, it's about to go down.
Shit like that.
You'll find that suspicious.
Bang, 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 bang.
You don't find that suspicious. You don't find that suspicious. You don't find that suspicious. You don't find that suspicious.
We got it. No sound effects. We were sharing the simple fact that, oh, y'all heard sound effects? Uh-oh, what are we doing? To this day. Okay, somebody said they heard the sound of Bumba Club.
To this day.
Let me work.
To this day.
Please let me work.
To this day. To this day.
Bang.
To this day.
To this day. Y'all get Marco.
You don't find that suspicious.
Bang, bang,
you don't
bang, 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 bang,
bang,
bang, bang, bang, bang, bang, bang.
Down the Marco, Marco.
Bang.
To this day. To this day. To this day.
Can't hear me? Oh, shit. I was talking this whole time. Okay. Can you hear the sound effects right now? Okay, we're back. So check it out. Let me know if y'all can hear me. Oh, you hear me now? All right, so boom. What I was saying was this, that this war or this conflict that you're witnessing and whatnot, this conflict is an artificial intelligence war drill, but it's a real drill. It's really going down. It's really taking place. But World War III, as you can see, the rollout and whatnot is going to be an AI war. It will be a war fought with new levels of data and intelligence. Israel currently has taken the lead as the quote-unquote country that will show you how AI will go to war, because they have 30,000 bodies on the side of Gaza and whatnot. And a result of that is the software that they're using called Gospel. The precision in which they destroyed Gaza in a short amount of time, the fact that they basically leveled the whole city and whatnot, is directly tied into the program that they're using, an AI program called Gospel. Now, outside of the program or the LLM that they were using to basically target people and destroy people, now they have robots entering into the killing fields. Okay, they have robots entering into the war. Okay, So the stakes are high. Stakes are high, okay? And it will never go back to where it was. Like this whole, we need to go back to the normalcy. No, that's not about to happen. There's no more. This is the new normal, right? This is the new normal. Wars in the air. For the month of Aries, okay, or for this Aries cycle, just prepare yourself to just, you know, see a lot of conflict taking place and just be very war ready. Okay. There's a war going on outside. Keep your head on a swivel. Don't live in fear. Don't live as a victim. Don't live as one who is going to, you know, automatically elect themselves as a victim, as a loser and whatnot. No, this war that's taking place, you're going to benefit from it. You're a benefactor of whatever conflict that is going down. Why? Because it was prophesied and it was taught to you and it was told to you that there's a war going on outside. So don't act surprised. Don't act surprised. And in this great reset that we're in and whatnot, there's a war going on inside. We can't point fingers at the behaviors that we see going on outside of self. What about what the fuck is going on inside of self and how that reflects on the outside? Because a lot of people that I know, they're going through some tumultuous times. They're going through roller coasters of emotions. They're going through depression states. You feel me? All of these things. Is my good brother Alki Balan in the building? Because I was seeing if he was. Real quick, Alex Jones says the Israeli government said they don't care if the whole world turns on Israel. They're going to expand the war. The whole world has turned on them. Remember, the disgraceful video below was leaked by Israel's own defense ministry. You can't bomb and slowly starve people on TV and not become the world's bad guys in the eyes of the world. Kill Hamas, not children. So I said it before, that they really lost the war at the end of the day, because the war of perception will beat any other type of war. Israel was able to coast through for the last 75 years, and pure people were completely oblivious to who these people were. They were not allowed to speak on them. They were not allowed to do research on them. However, that has changed dramatically. The younger generation, the newer generation, they are tapping in through TikTok. They are tapping in through Instagram. They are tapping in through many different means, especially with AI and the LLMs like ChatGPT and other way. They are doing deep diving research and breaking a lot of the codes. What are the codes? The codes were the fact that they had people sleeping at the wheel. They had individuals completely dumbfounded as to what the hell was going on and is it real. You couldn't talk about it. You couldn't talk about it. You feel me? That shit was taboo. It was taboo. And not only was it taboo, they had you really shedding crocodile tears on some Schindler's List type shit. And the whole time, the whole time, these was the Oppingtons. They were Oppie. It's like a classic episode of Scooby-Doo, my niggas. When we pulled a mask off, it was them the whole time. Like, there's information that I was able to unearth that I'm going to roll out in Vulture Culture, right? Where I'm going to show and prove that these people are never who they said that they were. These are the quote unquote, this is all mafia activity. And I'm not necessarily talking about the mafia the way that you were sold mafia by way of the the Italians through Hollywood. That's not the mafia that I speak on. I'm speaking on the Khazarian mafia out of Europe and whatnot. These are the big, this is the bigger mafia than the one that you see operating out of Italy and whatnot, Northern Italy and things of that nature. This is a bigger mafia. If you could wrap your mind around that and whatnot, outside of what you've been trained through Hollywood, that they run and they control, and they were able to switch up a lot of the quote unquote narratives. And they basically Kaiser Sose the game. If anybody watched the movie Usual Suspects, there's a character, the main character, the arch villain called Kaiser Sose. Kaiser Sose's famous line was, the devil was able to fool people by making you think that he did not exist. That was his superpower. He was able to function and move around because under the disguise of, you know, having somebody else be the devil, the black man, right? Being able to throw the devil on the black man. And this actually happened when the Moors were defeated. Go and research Dante's Inferno, right? One of the earlier depictions of this devil that you know about today. Prior to that, he didn't exist in literature, right? Dante's Inferno. They wrote him into existence, right? Dante's Inferno, all the way down to Baphomet, and the way that they depicted Muhammad and whatnot, all of that has to do with the negative backlash against the Moors. They went from being praised. They went from being looked at like they were the saviors or they were enlightened beings and whatnot, the illuminated ones, to now they were the dark ones who represented the devil, the red devil from the underworld. That scene in Lord of the Rings when they were making their army out of mud and darkness and whatnot. That's what they relegated us to. St. Patrick's Day when he's killing the snakes and whatnot, the Twa. That's us. Okay? That's us. Right. So all of these stories begin to become whitewashed. That is the period that they call their Renaissance. There's another period where they were beginning to change everything into their quote unquote images. They were whitewashing everything, cleaning up everything. The French Revolution. I mean, you name it. But during the whole time, we were there on both sides. Don't ever let anybody teach you or fool you or convince you of anything else, because that's not what it is, okay? They in Europe right now, these melanated people who are connected to these families and whatnot, I promise you, at the top, it's some niggas that look like Bridgerton and whatnot. At the top, bro. It's some people at the tippy top. You know? They might look like Drake. They may look like the girl who's married to Harry and whatnot. Or look at their child, Archie, right? And then when you see Drake's son, Adonis, look how he was able to produce a blonde-haired, blue-eyed child as an amalgamated Moor. Do you get it? Do you see how the Moors were able to go back and fall back into whiteness and whatnot? They were able to fall back into paleness when they had this whole thing where they basically begin to whitewash the gene pool and whatnot. You see it in Argentina, okay? You see it in Argentina. You see it in places like Mexico and in other places in South America where they were able to whiten up the bloodstream or the bloodlines. So the Adonis child is removed, right, from basically one degree, you know, he's one degree away because we know who his dad is. But he could pass. So there's a lot of people that are out here passing and whatnot, but they're not fully Nordic. They're not fully Nordic. You know what I'm talking about? So it goes deep. It goes deep, you know. It goes deep. We'll explore so many things to peel back that layer and whatnot. And we'll get into it. We'll get into it. You know? I'm going to show you some proof. I'll show you pictures. I'll show you some evidence of these amalgamated Moors, you know. Somebody said, is anyone fully? You know what? Genealogy, not red pill, because my opinion doesn't matter. The science is what matters. Don't go by my opinion. You feel me? Because that's subject to change. I would rather go to the science that is irrefutable, right? I would rather go to the science that is somewhat irrefutable. So genealogy is the order of the day, not the DNA and all of that other shit. The genealogy and the genome. Let's go ahead and get into genome, right? Let's get into genome, biogenetics and whatnot. Let's really begin to get in these wet labs and let's get under these microscopes and figure out who we truly are. You know? Because it's not like out of our reach and whatnot. It is not out of our reach. We do have access to the tools that we need to find out who we truly are versus who we're truly not. So the conversation is steering a lot of people in a direction to where they're going to make these breakthroughs. Shout out to Beyonce with the horse and the carriage and whatnot. You know, she's doing what she's doing with the horses. You know what I mean? Although Blue Pill did an excellent presentation on Black Magic 363, and he broke down why that whole cowboy shit is a dub. Like, we're not boys. We're not cowboys. We're horsemen and horsewomen and whatnot. We're not no boys and whatnot. But she's going to do what she's going to do. So shout out to her. But I read a post that she made when she dropped the album and whatnot, or when she dropped the promo for the album. And, you know, she was kind of like trying to get in her bag about why she decided that she wanted to do a country album, because she felt like the people was left out and whatnot. But then she went ahead and called herself a boy, a cowgirl or cowboy or whatever the cowboy, for anybody that doesn't know, is a derogatory statement, y'all. We don't rock with no cowboys because we not no boys and whatnot. So today happens to be the anniversary of the Blueprint 322. One of the reasons why 322 is such an important day to us, right, outside of the fact of its mystical properties and whatnot, is that was the name of the first lecture that we were basically that stamped us, you know what I mean? One of the first lectures that we did in the year 2009 and whatnot, it was Black Dot, Red and Blue, the Rabbi A.A. Rashid, okay, and Brother Ampu out of Philadelphia, right? And we bodied this shit. And this right here, it took us a lot of places. You feel me? And it could be revisited. This information is timeless that we laid out on this. You feel me? It is timeless. And I'm very proud of what we did with the Blueprint 322. It was a group effort, and we all came through and we made a certified bona fide classic that I would say shook the pillars of the matrix and began the mass waking up of the hip hop generation. You know what I mean? That's our fingerprints on that work right there. You know what I'm talking about? And if nobody is going to give us the credit, we're going to have to give it to ourselves and whatnot. We're going to have to toot our own horn and beat on our own chest. Because, you know, history is important. They're trying to take our history away from us as we speak to you. They're going to try to whitewash this conscious shit. You know what I mean? They're going to try to whitewash who is who and what is what and all of these other things. So it's imperative that the story is told the right way. Okay? So if my good brother Al-Kibalan is in a building, let me know. You don't see the link? Hold on. Give me 1 minute, y'all. Let me resend this to my good brother so he could pull up and do what he does. Y'all all right? Everybody in the building all right? Just checking on you. You know what I'm talking about? Y'all okay? on this Good Friday. On this Good Friday. You know? All right. How many people got Drake in the battle? How many people got Drake in the battle? Let me go ahead before I bring my good brother on. Let's go and hear the song. Let's go and hear the song that we talking about. You know? It's a war going on outside.
Let me fuck sneak this in first person shooter. I hope they came with three switches. I crash out like fuck rap. This Melly Mel if I had to. Got two T's with me. I'm snatching chains and burning tattoos. It's up. Lost too many soldiers not to play it safe. If he walk around with that stick, it ain't Andre 3K. Think I won't drop the location. I still got PTSD. Yeah, get up with me. Fuck sneak this in first person shooter. I hope they came with three switches. I crash out like fuck rap. This Melly Mel if I had to. Got two T's with me. I'm snatching chains and burning tattoos. It's up. Motherfuck the big three. Nigga, it's just big me. Nigga, bum. What? I'm really like that. And your best work is a light pack. Nigga, Prince outlive Mike Jack. Nigga, boom. For all your dogs getting buried. That's a K with all these nines. He gon' see Pet Cemetery, nigga.
Bomb dope, dealer selling dope. Is you like that? Kicking doors, kicking in doors.
Motherfuck the big three. Oh. Nigga, it's just big me, nigga. Bomb. What? I'm really like that. And your best work is a light pack. Nigga, Prince outlive Mike Jack. Nigga, bomb. For all your dogs getting buried. That's a K with all these nines. He gon' see Pet Cemetery, nigga.
Bomb dope, dealer selling dope. Is you like that?
They
squabbling. Yeah. March Madness, baby. March Madness. You know what I'm talking about? We promised you in the beginning of this month, March Madness. You know what I'm talking about? So, yeah, they get into it, you know? They get into it. That's what hip-hop is about. It's a sport. Yeah, every season all over again. K-Dot. This is Compton K right here. Lord have mercy. You know what I'm talking about? So yeah, he heating things up right now. He's heating things up. You know, he's heating things up. I just gotta say that my dude Kanye is somewhere with the evil grin in the corner with Northwest, just laughing his ass off. You know what I'm talking about? He's just laughing his ass off because now. You know, and that's another thing too. We got to give it up because, man, I can't wait to get the offering that Brother Blue Pill and Alkibalon 44 have put together called Conversations with the Cosmos. I was privy to get a little sneak peek on that project, and I saw what they was doing. They had a whole segment for Ye, but this is early Ye. So he done added about three or four chapters to his story. And, you know, it's just a wonderful, this is theater, by the way. You know what I'm talking about? This hip hop thing is like theater. So, you know, we're actually watching our good brothers in the theater of war and in the other theaters and whatnot play this thing out. You know what I mean? Hip hop is a divination system. So, you know, it's a lot of things going on, but I don't want to talk you to death, right? Because I do have our special guest in the building, and I do want to open up the line for the good brother. I don't want to be rude and whatnot and have a brother sitting around and waiting in the queue, you know what I mean? Because we definitely are here to form Voltron and do what we do best, you know what I mean? So without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, gods and goddesses, I present to you our good brother, your good brother, none other than the Don himself, Alkibalon 44.
To this day, you don't find. To this day.
Peace, God. Oh. Can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear. I can hear you loud and clear.
Word. I'm
were
getting
you able to hear the you heard the sound effects.
They came through a little bit. I heard a little bit. Snippet. Yeah. But I, you know, I was using my imagination. Yeah. No. But peace to the family. I'm just getting the visuals right first. I know Y'all can't see me on my end.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can hear you though.
Yeah, but nah, everything is culture. You did an amazing job with the opener. You know, for this lecture that we got coming up, you know, like we told them originally, it's going to be a lot darker. You know what I'm saying? But it's predicated to just where we're at in the world. You know, you pointed out Kanye West. You know, you pointed out Kendrick Lamar coming with the bars, with the diss with Drake. You know, you got a lot of, like, you know, you got Future who just dropped with Metro Boomin. You know, so it's just a lot of energy that's coming around that's predicated on a dark side, you know, of the spectrum. And, you know, to be honest, you know, again, all this information and everything that's coming out just in regular human affairs is parallel to, you know, the studies done back, which, you know, I'm going to touch on and get really, really deep in, yes, you know, in the lecture. But with the Montauk Project, the Phoenix Project,
yes,
a project called Project God Edge, you know, the Rainbow Project, all of these projects that were done in the, you know, late 40s, you know, it's resurfacing, you know, and also too, we're dealing with that dragon energy. So, you know, in the lecture as well, when we're talking about dark energy, again, we're not talking about nothing diabolical. You know, we're talking about the triple blackness. And when you, you know, engage in that level of energy predicated on doing it, you know, for a righteous cause, you're getting more into that tantric energy, more into that dragon energy, more into that, you know, cerebral spinal fluid, you know, and all of these things. So, you know, especially with these times that we're in now, again, dealing with that dragon energy, you know, a lot of manifestations are going to come through relative to merging with that electricity and that magnetism, you know, via tantra. So a lot of stuff that I'm going to talk about in the lectures is predicated on that. And again, when you look at it from the other end of the spectrum, from the more occult like spectrum, you know, we're going to touch bases on, you know, the figure that a lot of people may be familiar with, who is Aleister Crowley. And we're going to also tap into another guy.
Do what thou wilt.
Name, right. Another guy named Jack Parson as well, who dealt with rocket science. But he was a well-renowned student of Aleister Crowley, you know, and he dealt with a lot of sexual ceremonies and rituals, you know, that ties, again, back into the Montauk Project, the Philadelphia Experiment, and all of that. So, you know, we're in a very interesting time. And I feel like, you know, when you see, again, Kanye West and the aesthetic with the black, you know what I'm saying? You even got Playboi Carti, you know, who's in the news really heavy. And you already know what type of energy he bring, you know, because, again, not only is he seen with Kanye West, he's seen, you know, with Future. He's seen with all these figures that are coming out to the surface. So, you know, you can look at it from the standpoint of it being a cult-like, but again, this occult-like nature is predicated on a dragon energy, a more tantric energy relative to tapping into the unseen reality, predicated on bringing something from the unseen to the seen through, you know, representing that sexual energy. So, you know, we're going to get into a lot of interesting topics, you know, and with this lecture, you know, it's going to give people, you know, an opportunity to not only engage in a higher level of information predicated to the dark side, but also to see it from the good side, to see it from the standpoint where you can utilize this science in real time.
So.
And also, too, Red, I wanted to say, kind of switch up the vibe as well with this masterclass. If anybody wants the opportunity to come up and they want to speak, if they got any questions, if, you know, if they got any statements, you know, whatever Red said, because Red laid it out really well and kind of gave you a basis of what we're going to speak about. If you got any, perspective, if you got any viewpoint on Kanye West or, you know, anybody, you know, that's coming out relative to what we're talking about with this dark energy, you know, don't be shy to turn on the mic and, you know, step up to the plate and give us your perspective. So, I just want to open the floor to people who do want to partake and participate, you know, with us tonight.
Now, that's dope. That's dope. You know what I mean? I know we got some hitters out there.
Say that.
You feel me?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, yeah, we can make this, you know, again, don't be shy. We can make this build an open forum, an open discussion. You know, I feel like a lot of people, again, Red, like you and I have insight, and they always are privy to hearing us, you know, speak our language and, right, you know, go top floor with it, with the information. But I'm like, yo, there's like mad niggas and just women out there that have the opportunity, if they do, to deliver, you know, insight relative to what they see. Because a lot of times, you know, they got a broader perspective than we do sometimes. So, you know, I just be wanting to hear from the family and see kind of what they feel and how they, you know, how they see things. So.
Indeed, indeed. So if we have anybody in the building for my Zoom, right? For the Zoom family, if there's anybody out there in the audience that want to add on, go ahead. Yes. If there's anybody out there that wants to add on, do me a favor and put it in the chat first, and then I'll open up your line. We'll be ready for you, and then we'll let you come through and chop it up. You feel me? But like the brother said, don't feel shy. We are all experiencing the culture simultaneously. We are all experiencing this shift in energy. We are all experiencing this war that's going on outside and inside simultaneously. So we do all qualify to have a perspective and, you know, some type of vantage point. So the good brother is one, you know, he wants to open up the floor so voices can be heard and science can be dropped. You dig? Christopher said he gonna need a timer. Yeah, we not doing this is not dissertation night. This is the elevator pitch. So I would definitely encourage y'all to pull up and give us about 2 to 5 minutes of some some of that information that y'all holding on to. Because remember, and this is coming from somebody who utilizes, you know, the microphone and the stage to kind of like, you know, that's my therapy couch. You feel me? Like, if I didn't have the family to talk to, who would I run to? You feel me? If I didn't have the people, if I could not engage with my community or my network and whatnot, I'd just be talking to myself. So getting this shit off is a good feeling. You dig? So if there's somebody in the audience that want to get it off, let us know, and we'll definitely accommodate you.
Yeah. And then, you know, in the meantime, you know, while they do that, again, we encourage the family to tap in and purchase the tickets, because, you know, like what me and Red do, of course, you know, it takes a lot of time, you know, it takes a lot of energy. But, you know, our level of scope, where we could see things play out, is beneficial on so many levels, because, you know, we have to understand when we see these events that play out, they're coming from a higher nature. And like I've always expressed, you know, for those who've been following me, you know, we observe what we call these celebrities in such a fashion to where a lot of us get caught up in the personality worship or, you know, a level of even inspiration. But you got to understand that these people have a different level of entropy relative to electromagnetism, you know, even down to, you know, the walk of fame, you know, where they imprint, you know, their signatures into the concrete. They're imitating, you know, a specific script relative to something that's cosmic. And that's dealing with the Osirian mythology, you know, the death ritual, you know, so they get them caught up into a materialistic world, you know, and promise them an eternal life. But that eternal life is based on, you know, certain deeds that they have to do for others, you know, in these higher orders that we call societies or secret societies. And, you know, so they immortalize themselves in a physical nature. And what I mean is, you know, again, our ancestors understood that the idea, you know, was to supersede beyond a physical reality once we leave the body. But the idea is to return back to a star from which we came, you know, but their star is located in Hollywood, you know, so we got to understand that, you know, living a righteous life, you know, it's not just being conscious. You know, there's certain disciplines and certain, you know, morals that you have to follow in order to supersede beyond the physical body and return back to a star. And, you know, the way they got us engaged into this materialism through celebrities, you know, is detrimental. But that's why, again, me and Red lay out a foundation so that way we can, you know, remove the physical aspect of seeing these celebrities and seeing more in a way where we can be able to, you know, survey the environment based on decision makings that these individuals are making, because they're literally stars playing out in a physical world, you know? So it's a mythology, you know, it's an ancient mythology playing out through Kanye West. It's an ancient mythology playing out through Kendrick Lamar. It's an ancient mythology that are playing out through these characters. And if we can have the eyes to be able to decode these people relative to their sign, relative to the numbers they use, relative to certain languages and words that they're using, relative to, you know, titles of albums that they drop, relative to what colors they got on, you know, on the covers, or, you know, relative to, you know, who they got beef with, who, and, you know, who they going at, you know, next week. If we have the capacity to understand that, again, all of this is predicated on information that's that is coming from a higher nature, you know, then we lose the attraction of being attached to these individuals relative to personality, materialism, and we're able to really engage in an ancient mythology that is playing out in real time, because it's the same story that plays out all the time, you know, but the plot is different, the characters are different, the setting is different, but it's always the same lesson every time. So, you know, when you can have, again, a better gauge on what's going on in the society predicated on these individuals that we, you know, call celebrities, it'd give us a better perspective on our own individual lives and where we are in this cosmic script. So that's why I just feel like it's important that, you know, again, we hold these lectures, you know, vulture culture. When you look at vulture culture, we got to recognize, again, you can see the aesthetic playing out in real time. Like I said, you see Kanye West with the all black, but then you got to ask yourself, like, why, what does that mean though? What's the symbology in that? What does that represent? Because, you know, he was, you know, he was preaching Jesus, you know, three years ago.
The design language.
Exactly.
What is the design language? Because we have to always, we don't have to always, but when we deal with artists, right, true artists, not just rappers, but artists, they have the ability to speak without saying anything. That is an art form. That's something that we should, as artists, fellow artists and whatnot, and also as communicators, right? And also as connoisseurs of art, we should begin to identify and recognize how certain people are getting their quote unquote messages across. They know that, you know, everybody doesn't have to scream. Everybody doesn't have to make a fool of themselves. Certain individuals speak through their clothes, and their clothing is called design language. Henceforth, I'm not a fan of designers. Not a big fan of the Milan, Italy, French, you know, Roman designers. I'm not a big fan of them. I signed up to punish them when I was younger. We didn't celebrate them. We were making them take losses, you know what I'm talking about? And then we were flossing our stolen treasures. That's how we gave it up to them. But we wasn't about bragging about paying money for shit like that. That was not what we were doing. You know what I'm talking about? That's not I don't know where that came from. That had nothing to do with our childhood and how we came up in the culture. We were taught to get our reparations the best way that we knew how. And we chose cotton, right? But these designers, though, although I'm not into what they're talking about, they have stories. They have they like Rick Owens and whatnot. There's stories behind these designers. These designers have certain type of philosophies that are in inside of their design language, or the colors that they use, or the stitches that they have. Like, all of that shit is all quantifiable and qual. You got to talk to ASAP Rocky and them dudes. They'll give you the science on designer if that's what you into, right? And when these artists decide to communicate through their art, I'm paying attention, right? I'm paying attention. So like Alkibalon is saying, that when you see a certain look that these artists are beginning to embrace, the two biggest things that are running simultaneously right now is the conversion to Islam by the entertainers and the conversion into the occult by the entertainers. So they're moving into a space where they're embracing the darkness, dark magic, or what they would call chaos magic, the darkness, right? They're embracing darkness. There's a whole youth movement. You might not know about it, but I'm letting you know that the youth, especially, right, the young up-and-coming future, our future, the ones who are going to be carrying on tradition after we're gone, they're in their emo gothic phases right now. They're on some other shit, bro. Okay? And they're not necessarily telling everybody what they're on. You got to know what they're on. So they're dabbling into psychedelics. They're dabbling into, you know, certain type of tones and frequencies that activate a certain part of their psyche, right? Some of them are teetering on what they call crash out culture, to whereas they just don't give a fuck. They'll spank you in front of the police. It doesn't matter anymore with them. They're almost like kamikazes in a sense, but they're doing it for clout. So you have a lot of children who are crying out, right? Face tats, face piercings. I seen one of these kids with about 20 piercings in their face. What's the design language? What's being said to you when you see that, outside of people judging them and being like, oh, look at that kid. Well, how did that kid become that kid? And what part did your ass play in that kid becoming who he is now as an adult? What ball did you drop as somebody of an older generation? How did you neglect these? And are you still willing to neglect them? And just see and just see how much they're going to mutate into something else that you could point a finger at? Or are you going to begin to understand their plight, right, and speak their language and intercept them in their fall, or to make sure that they don't break their necks when they do fall? Because we fell. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we all fell. All of our generations had a rites of passage. We all look crazy. Did you look at them old pictures when your ass was wearing size 36 jeans and you was a 28.
Looking crazy. Yeah.
Looking crazy. Your long ass t-shirts looking like a nightgown and shit. You know, you thought you was fly as fuck. You know what I'm talking about? Parasuco jeans. You should be flogged for that. Yeah. Niggas fashion scent was horrible. You know what I'm saying? I'm just atrocious. You know? And nobody said nothing to you. You was knocking if you buck. So now with these children, they're going through, it seems that they're looking for any avenue to run down that they don't see adults on. They're just like, yo, wherever we could go where these old heads are not at, that's where we finna be going. We're going down any avenue that we could be the lord of the flies. They want to be their own boss. They want to be their own old heads. They want to be their own elders. So Crowley, Aleister Crowley, whose main goal was to separate the older and the younger generations, and they infiltrated the younger generations and put them on coke and they put them on these barbiturates, and they put them on these mind-altering drugs and whatnot, and then they fed them these 808 heartbreaks and these frequencies that basically put them underneath these spells, and they came with the sexual perversion.
That's a fact, and not to cut your wisdom, Brad, but, you know, again, like, let's go back to what you said in reference to, you know, the merging, and not even the merging, but you see, you know, in society, people converting over into Islam versus converting over into the occult.
Yes.
And, you know, first things first, for the family that's on, I definitely recommend you get a book called Tutankhamun's Prophecies. Like King Tut, but Tutankhamun's Prophecies. But aside from that, when you look at, for example, like King Tut's headdress, you notice he has a vulture and a vulture and a snake or serpent, yes,
serpent
next to each other, right? So again, we go back to Islam versus the occult, vulture versus the dragon or the serpent. You know, when again, you look at the vulture, you're looking at the darker nature of things. You know, the vulture likes to eat the dead carcass, right? And then when you look at the serpent or the dragon, again, you got a representation of an energy that's very tantric and sacred in nature that say, you know, people again like Aleister Crowley utilize, and, you know, things of that nature. But you got to understand that these parallels are in conjunction to, like we said, an ancient prophecy. So, you know, on a headdress, when you look at the serpent and you look at the vulture, and you look at it from a more scientific perspective, you know, the vulture, you know, flies above, and what the vulture is doing is it's looking for prey. But when a snake is, say, in the sand, you can see a snake leave its trails predicated on the slithering through the sand. And in ancient Kemet and in antiquity in general, the snake would always represent light. The snake would always represent waves or electromagnetic waves. So, you know, the vulture in this case represents an aerial view of the individual or the initiate having the capacity to see light or decode electromagnetic waves, which is information. So the two deities, or the vulture and the dragon coming out the forehead of King Tut, represents an initiate moving in step relative to being able to have that aerial view like a vulture to be able to see the serpent below slithering through the sand, which is leaving the mark, or what you would call a sine wave, or electromagnetism, which is information. So even if you look at it like this, like students in this class, students who are going to attend the lecture, in this case, again, we're dealing more in the occult side of things, the darker nature of information, but we would represent the vulture in this case based on the fact that we're moving into darkness, but darkness is nothing but a merger of light. Because in essence, there's no such thing as darkness. Darkness is actually light, but it's light and all of the light within the universe that have agreed to come together and become one, which deems it invisible, which is the triple blackness or the darkness. So going into the lecture, understanding that we're the vulture flying above, having the aerial view of certain levels of information, which is, again, electromagnetic waves, we have a greater capacity to not only see the dead, but to see the living as well.
Yes.
Full the spectrum. So understanding just both sides of this situation, again, just that little tidbit gives you an idea of a glimpse of what mythology looks like when it's played out in the present moment. And see, that's why it's important, again, when we have these type of lectures, when we say mythology, our minds automatically go back to Heru, or
right,
they go back to these certain deities. But I'm like, these are just personifications that represent forces of nature that our ancestors had the capacity to decode. Like, to now, so today, when we you know, take an observation of our reality in real time, there isn't still a mythology playing out. You know, it's not a thing where it's in the past. Mythology is playing out as we speak, you know. Right. So when we can insert ourselves into the character, like how I just explained, that's a prophecy. That's ancient mythology in real time. So, you know, that level of insight, again, is going to be key when we going into this information in the actual lecture. I want to say, too, because all this as well is, you know, has everything to do with the sun, has everything to do with the solar flares. You know, when you look at the dragon, of course, the dragon, you know, spits fire, you know, the yes. MC or the rapper spits fire. Like, that's the dragon energy. You're going to see a lot of, you know, artists going back and forth with each other, spitting fire, like the MC or the dragon. That's a dragon, or even a draconian energy, if you want to look at it from that standpoint. It's a lower base energy that's grounded more in a sacred energy predicated on utilizing the lower nature for combat, for mm-hmm. for competition, you know, and in all that, it's again the idea of understanding that the sun, as it's going through its cycles and as it's going through its, you know, development and building up its voltage, it's also spitting fire, just like the dragon, which deems, you know, the solar flares.
Yes.
And the deity in Kemet, if you look at the deity in Kemet, the deity in Kemet Min, M-I-N, if you look on the walls, this deity, which is a male, has an erected phallus.
Men, M-I-N.
M-I-N, the deity M-I-N. And what do? Men ejaculate plasma. So that's just as equivalent as the sun ejaculating plasma, which is solar flares.
The solar flares, right.
Which is information. So right. When we begin to understand that all these affairs that are playing out in real time is predicated on the information that the sun is delivering. The sun, specifically UV light, is rearranging and giving our viral DNA the capacity to self-assemble back into a crystal. And if you look at viruses, the head of a virus is a crystal. And that specific right. crystal is an icosahedron, which deals, of course, with sacred geometry. Now, all of our ancestors understood that once we make transition and we leave the physical body, we become virus or we become bacteria, which again holds information within that crystal, which is an icosahedron. So the solar flares that are coming in this year are very, very specific because what they're doing is they're reorientating the body predicated on DNA, because there's an imprint in the DNA that naturally has the know-how to not only self-assemble itself, but to survive beyond the physical body. So
yes,
once we understand that our behavior in our everyday lives, you know, basically is a foreshadow to, or not even a foreshadow. Let me rephrase that. The behavior in our everyday lives is really evidence of what's going on in our body via our viral DNA in real time. And I'll give you an example. Like, all of a sudden, if we start hitting the gym every day, which is a form of repetition, we go, you know, we realize we're on our fifth day, then we're on our sixth day or seventh day. What we're bearing witness to is we're receiving that information, specifically UV light. We're receiving that part of the sun, that information from the solar flares.
Yes.
That is engaging with our DNA to help itself unlock the information that is predicated on it knowing how to self reassemble itself back into a crystal or that icosahedron, which is that viral DNA. So that ordering comes natural within our everyday affairs. We start waking up and we recognize we start making our bed after 5 or 6 years of us getting out of the bed and not making it up. We start recognizing we start making the bed up every day. We start recognizing that once we come into the house, we begin to straighten up the shoes by the door. We weren't doing that 2 weeks ago, but all of a sudden we're engaging in a level of ordering. But all of our ancestors, again, was able to gauge human behavior and see, well, wait a minute, there's a level of ordering taking place. That means that basically the DNA within is self-assembling itself. And all of those crystals that we naturally have within us, which are viral, are encoding the information. So just that level of importance to understand that, you know, again, there's a reordering that's taking place. And this is all predicated on, again, the sun spitting that fire like a dragon. But it's giving us the ability also to engage in the superhuman abilities that we've already naturally had, which one of them, more specifically, is telepathy. The ability to engage in thought and literally communicate with somebody clear across the other side of the room or the house. So going back to the icosahedron, when you look at the vial DNA, when you look at a virus, again, the virus has an icosahedron, which is predicated on sacred geometry. If you then parallel that to the Montauk Project, which, you know, I'm not going to go too much into now, but I'll speak about it briefly here. They had a machine, which you call the Delta T antenna. And what they developed after so many experiments is that this, and you can even pull it, you can pull it up, anybody, you know, on the live right now, they can pull it up. But the specific shape of a Delta T antenna is an icosahedron, because they understood that, again, utilizing a Delta T antenna, they were able to literally take thoughts of other individuals and teleport those thoughts into other people's mind. So with that specific machine, which actually Nikola Tesla backed up as well, is they recognized, well, wait a minute, we don't even have to utilize machines anymore to brainwash people. We can literally transmit our thoughts like a group think, or like you speak about, Red, what they call it, an egregore. Utilize thoughts, basically, to teleport or transmit thoughts into other people's minds in order for them to engage into whatever action, you know, the giver of the thought wants that receiver to engage with. So saying all that to say, the idea is to, like, you know, everybody on this live and myself and Red does, is observation. And intentionally, observation. Right. And intentionally every day getting up and reordering your day. Doing things intentional, being very specific and strategic, because, again, the DNA is looking to survive right now. You know, with all the foods that we've been eating that's toxic, with all the air that we've been breathing in that's toxic, with all the music that we've been listening to, you know, that's toxic. Our DNA is completely compromised. But literally the year 2024, vulture culture, dealing with an aerial view of seeing electromagnetic waves at a higher capacity, the idea is to understand that this dragon or these solar flares is breathing fire with information that's naturally encoded within this light that's reordering the microbiome. So every day, get up with intention and start reordering things. And you'll be able to see that, you know, like I've always said, when you begin to do those small steps, you know, supernatural doors will open up for you because you're moving in step with the mythology of the sun. You see? So, like I said, we're going to get deep into the lecture because I want to speak more about the Delta T antenna. I want to speak more about Project God Edge, the Phoenix Project, and all of that. And this is all dealing with mind control. This is all dealing with telepathy, which is the supernatural abilities that are coming online as we speak. You know, this is dealing with, a whole nother level of information, family, a whole nother level of, again, supernatural abilities that we innately have. And that's what's coming online. So the year of the dragon literally is dealing with supernatural abilities that we naturally have. And this is predicated on the reordering of the vial DNA, predicated on the information from the sun.
Damn. Okay. Well, we got some questions. The first question that I have in the chat is they want to know what your Cash App is.
My Cash App?
Yeah.
My Cash App is Alkibulan 44, dollar sign Alkibulan 44.
Got you. And then we have somebody in the audience that wants to ask, they want to add on. I did drop the link as well. I do want to know who is pulling up on the 7th, all right? The day before the solar eclipse, we are going to be doing our presentation on the 7th, the day before the eclipse. So much is going on. So much information is dropping, right? That it's only right that we get everybody prepared the day before up into this quote unquote solar. You're going to hear a lot of noise. There's going to be a lot of quote unquote confusion taking place. So we made it our business to walk the family through to make sure that we're going to get it in on the quote unquote on the 7th, right? And also what's about to take place before we get it in on the 7th is the good brother Alkibulan is going to be bringing back the God Body Challenge. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about? So mm-hmm. not only are we going to be getting our minds right, but we do have the opportunity to get our bodies right leading up to this monumental presentation. So we could really, really, you know, I would just say we could ritualize this thing. You know what I'm talking mm-hmm. about? We could consecrate what it is that we're doing as a collective and put some charge and some power into it, you know? So look out for that. That's coming up, okay, on the 7th. And I did drop the link inside of the quote-unquote chat, inside of Zoom. So click on the link and make sure you get your tickets, the early bird tickets, because they will be more leading up to the 7th. Brother Christopher, if you in the building, please come forward, my good brother. Please come forward and share some of your light with us. Come and build with the family.
Right. I might need 10 instead of 5, right? Because you brought up the emos. Because when I was growing up, they would consider me one, but I didn't really call myself one. We kind of better called the misfits because we wasn't the geeks or the blurs. Right. We kind of made fun of both of them. We kind of talked about it before. Yeah. We the real talent in the community. We the ones nobody know about. If you go, for example, to the fighting game community, people don't know it's a black community ran by a dude named IFC Yipes. So that's my proof for you. The electron
that, the fam game?
The fighting game community, my bad.
Okay.
FGC. So like Street Fighter and all that, Tekken. Yeah. It's a dude named Yipes that he's a cool dude. He's a nigga. You feel me? You just get running that. The electron, to talk about that, the irony of the whole conversation, to kind of add to what you're saying, is that it's two-phased because of relativity. The electron's only technically move in one direction, but we got to represent it as two, because when you apply relativity, you have another perspective, and we know some things are heavier than others. For example, crystals, they're very dense. So crystals naturally, and all the fields come from this. It creates gravity and all of this. Scientists are just catching up to some of them, putting a bunch of different thoughts together in a short amount of time. Who cloned Tyrone, right? And this is going to be how I wrap it up. Who cloned Tyrone was about a nerd who wanted to be a hood dude, a nerd that couldn't fight the way he wanted to fight. And the problem is, a lot of the nerds, I used to beat their ass in video games all day, and they didn't like me for it. So the nerds started bullying the misfits because the misfits was on our Christ ship. We was being forgiven. We was being, you know, we was picking up the Bible. We was in our phase in our consciousness. But after time, we ain't have no more cheeks left to turn. So we became the bullies. We weren't bullying nobody. You know when in the classroom, when a bully finally gets caught up and get fucked up by the wrong person, that's what happened. So now the nerds are in the front calling themselves blurs, trying to convince the greater black community that that's where the talent is. But in reality, it's just a giant orgy. Those were the kids who used to make fun of the jocks for getting pussy because the jocks led the woman because the women thought they were cool because they act like they're older men who came before them. So all of that trickled down until the women finally realizing that we've been telling them that you're going to be guided towards destruction. I can follow them because the men who followed their following did the same thing. Mm. So nobody listened to us. We're the kin to consciousness and nobody even knows. We've been listening. We've been chilling. We've been watching. We've been observing. We've been learning more than anything else, because if you call yourself a teacher, it's my job to learn. So there's this huge disconnect going on right now. And I know everybody's looking for who's supposed to be put on or who's the next. But they right in your face. They come to y'all when they come to y'all. You just got to know how to see them. These motherfuckers now, they fool, man. I done stood up against the military by myself and lost all my rank. I ain't give a fuck. I stood up against the CTO by myself. I really don't care. My sister, right? This is the point of all of this. She's in a courtroom, and her power was so demanding that she made the whole courtroom sit down just by speaking more than once. What I was saying when I said the royalties in the NYCHA projects is the way they created the illusion was they took some of the royalty out. They made them celebrities, so it was hard to distinguish where the royalty was. After royalty looks like the celebrities, and I put a bunch of fake people near them, or right. The Tyrones near them, they're going to all look like either Tyrone or all look like royalty, because right. People don't know how to use discernment yet because they're not listening to the teachers. But in this situation, no one's free from blame. The teachers, like you said, had to make a mistake that the students aren't listening. Simple as that. Who has the authority to mandate what the students do? The only thing that separates a teacher and student is the authority, whether given by state, government, or God himself, however you subscribe to it. But in reality, right. We all fell because, I mean, this is our people. And we have to all see where in our hearts we feel we need to do better to avoid these harsh words like failure. But we got to learn how to eat it. And the reason why I brought up the fighting game community is because that's where I learned how to take a loss, by getting my ass kicked. And I couldn't punch the nigga right next to me because he kicked my ass. It taught me how to train my lower self. So when I'm in the world and some goofy motherfucker try the same shit, I'm chilling. Right. I done took way greater losses than anything you could fathom. So The moral of the story is we got to know where the royalty's at. I know where my family is. Nobody had to tell me. I knew when I was young because I knew what I could see when I was 3. So everybody has to see this. It's a huge disconnect, like the young conscious community. That's only formed because the conscious community. High-level conversations creates a lower-level conversations, and now they're trying to reemerge. So you got fuckboys having high-level conversations. High-value man, same problem. You have a valuable man. That's all you need. Once you create high value, it must be low value. What is low value going to try to do? Merge back with the high value. So you got fuckboys calling themselves high-value men. It's the language. It's so powerful that people don't understand. They call it Babylon, but it's not. It's the thing that puts it all together, not the thing
NLP. That puts it all apart. Yeah, natural language processing.
So
it's a spellcaster.
Exactly. And you know how the spirits are in binary. Binary comes from voltage. Voltage comes from the electric. You know, it's my profession, right? So I understand it real deep. It's the master teachers are saying it. But sometimes your head is slightly to the right. For example, you want to turn a square into a circle or a diamond into pi? That's what pi is. All pi is a translation. Quantum mechanics deceived everybody, because if you go into the history and you do a discernment on that, you're going to learn that Albert Einstein, the counterculture to him was quantum mechanics. In fact, it goes all the way back to Rome when the people telling the truth were getting killed because they were physicists or natural scientists. It's been the same story, like you're saying, since back then. It just keeps repeating and repeating and repeating. And until we figure it out as a collective, not as individuals, how to move forward, we're going to keep repeating, repeating, and repeating. And I've been here for a long time, and I'm tired of going to wake up, going back to sleep, waking back up. Y'all ready yet? Oh, no, they're not ready yet. Go back to sleep. Another century. Y'all ready yet? No, they're still slaves. Go back to sleep. That's what we're going through. The gods is here. The great ones are here. They're just waiting for everybody to figure out who they are, because we can't move in our greatness by ourselves. It's like it's not a limitation. It's just the truth. I see them with my eyes. I see them with one.
Facts.
But I can't be the only one seeing them. The blurs are the first. They're the gatekeepers for the real talent. They're there to fool everybody. The crowd. You got to search through the crowd and realize these motherfuckers are fools. These niggas don't know what they're talking about. The misfits are killers. They was in the hood, really. The fighting game communities, them niggas is killers. Like, for real. But then nobody see. That's where the warriors are. It's a coliseum. You just watch it. Go and watch it. It's a coliseum. and they're banging on tables, they shouting when somebody get fucked up, and you got to learn how to take that and not get mad. That takes a very strong person. Because I took an L before, and I ain't do it too good. I lost in Golden Eye. I was like, fuck out of here. And I had to eat it. So I'm kind of just rambling because I'm trying to stuff it all in a short amount of time.
Yeah, that Golden Eye L is real.
It's real,
shoot your lights out. Yeah, that was a big L. Because remember Golden Eye, the whole screen would turn red when you get shot poof, and you slide off? Because that was like the first person shooter. That was like the first person shooter that we was rocking with.
And that was a classic. I had that on Nintendo 64.
Man, remember GoGo 13?
The who?
GoGo 13.
I don't remember that, but I remember Star Fox.
Woo. That was my favorite.
Yeah.
GoGo 13.
GoldenEye definitely separated the boys and the men. It was this character named Agile that everybody knew. If you use him, you was a bitch because he made a disadvantage that was implied. So you always have the one dude who will pull up. Like, I don't want to lose so bad that I'm going to break the code of honor. It's kind of how you was talking about with the morals. It's always that one. And now the fighting game community is just plagued with people like that. And it's gotten so bad that the game developers, they're starting to lose money because people aren't watching no more. It got so boring. It's like watching a UFC fight, but everybody running in circles. And they're afraid to throw the first punch because they're afraid to get hit. That's what it became. A bunch of pussies, for lack of better words. So but now it's the game developers are trying to incorporate the gamers, but they're picking the gamers that made this playstyle popular. Pretty much the people that wanted to win so bad they didn't care the cost. We know who they are. It's not just in one community. I promise you, whenever I see someone differentiate themselves from the rest of the fucking people, I already know who you are. That's why I never liked when I heard high volume man, that was the first sign, but it wasn't the man who said it. It was the people listening. And they all decided to turn it into the quip. Now we all are high value men, or high level conversations. But what does it really mean? Like, really, what makes you fit to be a black leader? Well, I did this. All right, where's the fruits of what you did? Oh, well, what did you do? No. I never proclaimed to be what you are. You have the burden of proof. And I go through this in spirit with so many people because it's called a rites of passage. Right. You don't just get that. I have my dead mother's in my hand. I have my rites of passage. You can't tell me shit. Other people don't have that. So when it comes down to it, you got to ask, one, what did this person pay to get that knowledge? I just told you mine. Where's everybody else's? We have to be on some real shit because niggas is out here perpetuating all around us and we just chilling like it's cool. And we what? We Scorpios. We know what our job is.
Right.
Clean up the street sweepers. The dirt don't like when the street sweeps, so they call us devils.
Right.
Now, real quick, who is Kanye West imitating right now? We just spoke about a video game that we all three played.
Right. GoldenEye.
GoldenEye. But who is Kanye West imitating?
Depends on if he's a main character.
Well, he's imitating Jaws. You know the look, the grill that he got?
Mm-hmm. Right. He did
That was inspired by the character in Jaws.
He did say that.
All right, that was inspired by the character in 007 that was named Jaws.
So here's a layer to that, right? So the character Jaws, know how I brought up Aja? The reason why people didn't like him was because he was short. So if you remember, it took so long to change your aim that one little disadvantage would just make it hard for you. Jaws was the opposite. He was taller. So picking Jaws counted Aja. So I used to pick Jaws to counter Aja. So when someone's like, I'm going to use this character because I know it's going to give me an advantage, well, I'm going to cancel that advantage with this character and then make it all wrap in for you, Red. They call this the meta and the anti-meta. Mm. The NPC conversation, this shit go all the way back then. We've been talking about this. Right. This meta thing that everybody's caught up in, that's everybody who's trying to be conscious. Everybody who's trying to be like Red Pill, but they can't say who I am. That's the meta. The way we say it in the fighting game is you're fighting with the meta to be your own individual. You're trying to be one of the best, but you got to fight everybody playing like the best to get to the best.
To get to, right.
The meta is based on the best players, but everybody thinks the meta is the best. So that goes back to the blurs and the misfits. The meta ain't the best. It just looks like it. Same thing, everybody making AI. The dual clones and shit, we don't own that because we don't own the hardware. So same problem. I'm going to end up going on for too long. I'm way past 10 minutes.
Remember Misfits of Science?
No, but I'm going to look that up.
You don't remember the Misfits of Science? the TV show that we used to watch at that this it came on. I don't know if it was around the time when Incredible Hulk was on, the real life Incredible Hulk, like with Mr. McGee, the live action.
Mr. McGee.
They used to have us in a grip on TV, the Incredible Hulk. You would have to be like a 70s baby though to remember that, because that was like, that was, we had Wonder Woman, we had the Lee Majors, the Bionic Man, $6 Million Man, and Incredible Hulk was the biggest TV show of that line. It became on Thursdays. Yeah. With David Banner.
Yeah, I remember that Incredible Hulk. I'm not too young to remember that one.
Okay.
I don't think I ever remember
that. Yeah, the Misfits of Science. That was the shit. That was the ill TV show. And then you had later on Weird Science was the movie where they made the woman like they doing AI. They generated a supermodel and whatnot. And you know, they, it's like a 3D print. They created a woman, a vixen. And that was like the beginning of this whole nerd vixen type of infatuation. It went from like the Playboy bunny, because remember, we're talking about incels. You understand?
Yeah.
Talking about Bill Gates and them, early pictures of fucking Jeff Bezos, like this nigga's looking like a, he's looking like Biff. You know what I'm talking about? It's like a Biff. It's crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like early Elon Musk. They had like, you know how niggas be having a flaky shit when white people get old and they be having a flaky skin and whatnot. These niggas had flaky skin at like 20. You know what I'm talking about? He was peeling. It was a fucking, he had a like leprosy and shit. This is Elon Musk, the African with a K, who just showed his hand with Don Lemonhead, that he was basically, he just exposed him as being a centralist. And, you know, he exposed his hand. He's a fucking African. He's nothing more, nothing less. And we did this show where we showed the four pale horsemen, the real apocalypse moving forward, the four pale horsemen who are the, they're ushering in transhumanism. And they're ushering in they're ushering in what Ray Kurzweil set up, which is basically the 5 to 6 epochs of man. And we're currently in the third right now, where AI is on the scene and whatnot. And then we're going to move into AGI, sentient and whatnot. And then they're going to merge man with machines with bio. So you're going to get the bionic man. And then the sixth epoch is man or man's mind in the universe becoming one. So they're going with the plant. They're going all the way the fuck in. None of them are ops of each other. That's wild theater and whatnot. You have Sam Altman is not a part of the Four Horsemen. It's Elon Musk. It's Peter Thiel, who's popping back up. He's from the PayPal Mafia. He's a very dark, sinister Chichi man. Jeff Bezos, right? No, it's Mark Zuckerberg, it's Elon Musk, it's Anderson Horowitz, and it's Jeff Bezos. Those were the four pale horsemen who are all part. Anderson Horowitz is the funder. He's the money. He's the bank. He's the one who put on all of these Silicon Valley unicorn tech companies. They got to go through his incubator, which is called A16Z. He knows everything that's coming. They put out all of the white papers on where AI and technology and everything is going. So if you control the bread like BlackRock and Vanguard, if you control the venture capitalism, right, you get to control the pace at which the AI and everything is developing. You know about everything 6 months in advance because you are paying the budgets. Like, you're footing the bill for shit to get created. So all of them theoretically are coming in from the left angle, the side angle, the overhead and the under angle to help progress man becoming God on this earth by doing what? once they are able to disrupt aging, and once they're able to disrupt death, they become the new Illuminati or the technocratic society, where you're gonna have to have 100 bitcoins in order to live to be 200. That's why all of this, you know what I mean? That's why they're collecting the ether. They just went and private this whole shit with the Ethereum. Ethereum, it will be a token. It won't be a cat. It won't be utilized as a money. It'll be utilized as a tool for these banks and these other quote unquote institutions in order to do transactions and whatnot. We don't have our hands on Bitcoin. We cannot get Bitcoin at this point. It's over. Let that shit go. I don't want nobody losing hair and getting FOMO, but you can get Ethereum though. It's only, it's under four bands. We could get 400,000 and get the motherfucking Ethereum and put that shit into a trust and just let that shit do what it do. You're going to earn the Bitcoins, but it's too late for all of that to really, like, you know what I'm talking about? When it was like 16 bands, we could have had it, but you know, as you can see, yeah, when it comes to shit like that, the hype is what pushes people. The hype wasn't there, so we initiated the conversation. Motherfuckers was like, yeah, what about, they was worrying about some whole nother shit. What about those Beyonce tickets? You know, they was trying to go on a Renaissance tour. We trying to get Bitcoin at 16 bands. But they wanted Beyonce, so that's who they got. They got B, my nigga. They got B. So I hope I hope that they could do something with those B tickets. I hope they could get reimbursed for the motherfucking Taylor Swift tickets, because all of that is gone and niggas are still left with nothing. Feel me? So yeah, the nerds are pushing the misfits out the way. And yeah, they on their nerd shit. I'm going to marinate with that, Christopher. That shit right there just had me like, woo.
Yo, it's deep. And I just need like more time, because I got to cook. It's so much to it, man. I like 3-4 weeks ago, my wife was getting on her nerves. I'm like, babe, I got to get this out.
And well, it's like, who the fuck could we talk to? You know what I mean? I need a box in my house I can put my head into and just talk to that shit and be like, do you hear me? And somebody just answer back like, yes, Philip, I hear you. Keep going. Yeah, man. Niggas need like a bag to just yell into and shit. And put it up somewhere. Just like mail that shit. Like, I'm going to mail it to Alkeem along, yo. I just yelled in this shit. You get the message. Because we need somebody to talk to. We have to express these emotions that are moving through us like energy. It's energy and motion ramped up. Like Alkibalon said, the sun is having, you know, it's having solar flares. It's letting, you know what I mean? It's busting shots. It's on his K dot shit. It's on his Kendrick. You know what I'm talking about? Like it's going at us.
I think we need our four horsemen in tech too.
I mean, I would definitely suggest that there were to be some type of balance. Like if they could, if we could counter those four horsemen we see riding and whatnot. And keep in mind,
they're not strong, right? I've been in
they're
the
not,
field.
They're
I've
not. They're not.
They're weak.
They're not. They are. They take very power weak. Ideas. They are same, very weak. They're allergic to the sun. Let's just leave it at that. They're allergic to the flares. Those bunkers that they're trying to build, it's not going to save them. It's not going to save them, bro. They could go into every fucking bunker that they built. That's not going to save them, bro. That the simple fact that they ready to run should tell you something. It ain't it. But if they convince poor people to fight against poor people, do you see the propaganda that they're doing with the migrants? Do you see how they're building up this civil war? Do you see how they've done this shit? They're playing from a playbook.
They waited for y'all to leave to Atlanta. You know that?
Yeah,
that
they was did.
Time. That was yeah. time. It was when I came back to New York, I'm like, it's like a gap of power right
they
now.
Collapsed just that shit. Yeah, they collapsed that bitch. You see that shit turned into Gotham City in no time. And yep. they running all kind of plays all up and down that grid that was sacred at once. And yeah, they are doing some fucking some high level spirit cooking in New York. However, you know, the energy coming from Atlanta, you feel me, is dark. It's a dark energy, and it's also an energy that's a disruptive energy. And you know, we'll get New York back. You know what I'm talking about? Eventually, you know what I mean. It would definitely return. But the work is being done. The work is being done. Shit is collapsing at a fast pace, you know, and they panicking. Look at the girl, Kate Middleton. She got cancer, right? How the Royals got cancer.
Right.
Where the fuck does that? And she's young. How she got cancer? And King Philip, or no, King Charles, Charles in charge. Not Charles Flannery, Charles in charge. Charles from the UK. He got cancer in a rectum, I think.
Oh.
And he's their king. This is the Scorpion King born on my birthday. He's the king. He's about to abdicate the throne. Dude who's going to come up next, he don't got a queen because she got cancer. Like, this whole shit is finished, bro. The Pope is on the way out. So it's like, what are we even, what are we, like, we supposed to be exasperating the downfall, the great fall is taking place before our very eyes. They talk about, they don't have nobody new to hand this shit to. Their progeny is listening to Playboy Cardi. They want to be black.
Oh, you know, to add to that, you familiar with Bronx River Projects?
Yes, in the
Bronx,
I am.
Bronx. So I was born and raised there. And
that's
so the old
heads, them, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. The old heads used to tell me about all that. And essentially, the way it looks to me is that, you know, as above, so below. So the curse of stuffing a bunch of the royalty inside of the projects, we don't stop being royal. We still got all our power just sitting there, not being used. That shit turned into a curse real quick. So when people started to turn it into word, and that word reached the world, they just became part of the curse. Now, the irony is that, guess what's happening to black people? And what I said to my wife, I said, once black people stop separating themselves, like when conscious and unconscious is why I brought that up, the black man and black woman, it starts becoming the black family, it's over. We're going to stop fighting. Once it becomes the leaders are established and the knuckleheads in the street that shooting, they scared of niggas like me. They are. They don't. They it looks like niggas is really ready, but they scared of my sisters because my sisters will really smack the shit out of them, and they scared of it. They only have the guns because they feel safe with the gun. But when you don't know what a nigga's gonna do to you, that safety go out the window because some of us radiate that. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about. So what I've learned is that. Those of us like that, that's a form of leadership. The fact that I'm commanding you without even doing anything. I'm not even thinking. I'm just walking down the block. And you feel the need to just move out of my way. I have a big-ass black German shepherd, too. Another methodology I learned. She becomes an area of protection. And people move out the way. The guns don't mean nothing. You ain't going to shoot that shit at me. You wouldn't dare shoot it at me. Your ancestors can't pay that price, dog. You ain't going to shoot that gun. And I don't have to say that. It's known. So... It's about positioning. The right leaders are not in the right position. There's too many people calling leader, and they ain't got the juice, right? They ain't got the oomph. We need niggas. We don't need people that's like, oh, Ashe. We need them for their purpose. You feel me? That has its place, but right now, we're on war times, and we need to start moving like niggas on war. That's why I went in the military. I'm like, everybody's saying the three-letter agencies is doing it. Let me see how they're doing it so I know how to fight it. But everybody's like, oh, we got to run away. Obviously, everybody handled it their own way. The point is, we got to learn how to fight and stop running. I stood up. I was telling you earlier, I stood up in my platoon because I had this bitch-ass NCO. He was a Mason. Mm-hmm. And they didn't like me, long story short, because I wasn't scared of them. And I don't care how many of y'all here. If we're going to go there, we're going to go there. Right. So they don't like that. So they say, oh, you don't want to get in line? Nope. So we gonna mind control you. It's not gonna work, bro. I'm letting you know you are wasting your time and creating karma that's not gonna bend well for your son. Stop it. Still ain't listen. All right. I talk to you in spirit. Now I guess I gotta talk to you in person. Long story short, some racist shit happened. I walked out of formation. You get a lot of trouble for that. You're not supposed to walk out of formation. I didn't give a fuck. Came back, gave me the speech, and I was trying to tell him, like, we got racism going on right now. Long story short, we don't need that here. That spirit is not good in a mixture of black and white people. It's going to tear us apart. Right. I'm trying to say that. Motherfucker started yelling, talking over me. What he fucked up was he stood up out his seat like he was going to do something. I stopped being specialist Gaston. Now we... I dropped my parade vest. This is my arms are behind our back and shit. I dropped that and I started walking straight toward him and he sat back down. That diffused me. Like, oh, he's scared. And I kind of snapped back too. Like, I'm about to go to Leavenworth. That's military jail. I'm about to lose everything I'm doing, and I'm doing this for a reason because of this one knucklehead. But Red, for us with this power, you know how we're tested. That we're tested with the I don't want to be mean, with the people in the way. They just there to just test to see what you're going to do. And it kept happening. And even when I got out, same thing kept happening. I'm like, why am I keep being tested like this? Because I got to deal with knuckleheads. I got to train them. The reason why they ain't listening to the teachers is because they don't got the training to sit down in the classroom and listen. I got nieces and nephews in the Board of Ed, and they always tell me they bored. And the first thing I said is a mass of teachers need to be teaching in New York City, period. That's going to solve the problem. The confusion is they say, well, what we going to teach? Go to the schools. I teach physics, get the degree, and go to New York City. We got to go. We got to take our knowledge back. We got to go back in the schools. We can't do it on the internet. We got to go get the bachelor's degree. We need Dr. Phil, bro. That's what we got to do. But Dr. Phil can't be Dr. Phil on his own. The community got to support that, too. You know, the what I learned from the Bible more than anything is God's law is a law of unity. It's a law of one. We have to unite under one purpose. And we don't have that yet because everybody who's talking about it ain't being heard because that's them nerds in Yahweh. The misfits that would listen to y'all, they can't hear y'all because them nerves are in the way. It's like a double-way door. They're gatekeeping both sides. And then like every part of our culture is this barrier between every part that don't make no sense. It don't make no sense that the scientists and the conscious community ain't talking because once quantum mechanics became a conversation, guess who should have got involved?
Right.
But they wanted to stay outside and say, well, they don't know what they're talking about. Motherfucker, y'all don't know what y'all talk about. I eat scientists up for breakfast because I don't argue with them. I just use their words to show them what they're saying. Same thing with the Israelites, whether they be the white ones or the black ones. Everybody's just talking in circles, talking in circles. Everybody got the answer, and yet we have the same problems for the last 400 years. So who really has the answer?
They got the answer, but they're not problem solving. To have the answer is not enough.
They train to solve the problems that the white man talks.
Right. We got to hack. The hacker is the problem solver. That's all a hacker means. You know, when somebody hacks something, you solve it. So we got 99 problems, and how many of them can we hack, right? Because that's where the glory is. The glory is in solving these hackable problems. They're not real problems. They're all hackable, right? So we have to become the programmers. And we have to become the engineers, and we have to basically knock down each one of those problems until we get to that one. Okay.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't like with our people. And again, you know, for me, like, and just in general, like we're not being practical with the science. Like we could say we know physics and quantum physics and all this, but it's like, do we know how to apply that in real time? Or for me personally, this is why, you know, I'm going into these Western, you know, schools, you know, and I'm taking courses to this day. Like I'm, what was a school for mechatronic engineering, and that's dealing with computer science, electrical engineering, and mechanical engineering. So, you know, even in real time right now, as we speak, I'm working as a mechanical engineer. So, you know, learning how to weld, learning how to, you know, work with CNC machines, break them down, build them back up, knowing how to use our physical hands to know how to build. A lot of us, we've lost the appetite to want to get into certain skill sets that we've naturally had. Like we always say our ancestors were engineers and scientists. And then we then turn around and ask the question, well, who built the pyramids? Mm-hmm. Well, didn't our ancestors just say we were scientists and engineers? Like, so, you know, not only that, but we learn and master mathematics and things of that nature. So we tend to get intimidated by a lot of these formulas and equations that these Europeans present to us. But it's like it's all stems from us at the end of the day. But again, I don't want to continue to shy away from the fact that, you know, we got to become like more demonstrative in our actions in real time. Right. And we don't have to rely too much, you know, on Western's academia per se. I've chosen to go into it because I wanted to learn the logic and the analyst in the left side of the brain relative to how they taught and how they think. So that way I can juxtapose that to how our ancestors thought and taught and think when it came to mathematics and science. So for me, when I look at a circuit board, I can compare a circuit board to the body. I can look at a circuit board, compare a circuit board to how they designed the pyramids relative to ley lines on the continent. You know what I'm saying? I can look at welding and I can compare that to something in conjunction to the body. So it all is encompassing, but we have to stop compartmentalizing things like the European does. Yes. Start merging it all together, because at the end of the day, when again we talk about science, engineering, and mathematics, it's all the same language. Right. But you know, once we agree on a universal standpoint what direction we're going to start going and start going in that direction, being more practical with our information, then I think we can get somewhere. But if we continue to speculate and sensationalize the pyramids as if it's something that's not a part of us,
right,
then we can never get anywhere.
Facts. I have another guest that wants to build with us. Is Keto in the building? Keto, pull up, please.
Hi, it's Keto.
Keto, peace. How you doing? Greetings.
I'm well. I appreciate you, Rich Phil.
Yes, likewise.
A Cubalon, I really do. I've been learning so much from both of you. And as someone who has been in music all of my life, as a jazz pianist, and more recently as a spitter as well, producer, I've also been teaching music. And I have this passion, I have the clarity now of how I'm moving forward now. Because I've been teaching in real life, like the brother was just saying, we need to build with our youth in real life, meet them wherever they are in real life. I've been doing that. And it's really, really clear how powerful we are collectively. And it's amazing to me that even after all of the programming, after all of the things that's happened to us, we still have so much strength and power, and our youth still show up. The fact that they can show up at all, period, to me is a really big deal. And they have a lot of issues that we all know about, we've been talking about, we're all clear about it. But I'm really encouraged because they push through, and it's always somebody to support them. And I've been privileged to be one of those people to do so. And it's been kind of difficult for me because I'm an artist. I was a child prodigy type of artist, making a living playing jazz, piano, blues, piano. And I'm also a spitter, though. Like, I have a lot to do as an artist. So I'm not able to continue with the teaching in real life, but I am developing online courses. I have written books. I have books for music fundamentals for our youth.
Okay.
Because I see a major solution to be playing instruments. Our children need to see themselves as instruments. They need to be educated about the fact that we created everything that comes out of America, period.
Right.
Significant when it comes to music, and it's such a divide. You feel me? Like, it's such a divide. I'm in the Bay Area, transitioning to the ATL, so I'll be seeing you in a couple weeks because I'll be at the James Smalls.
Okay. Smalls, yes.
Lecture. Awesome. So,
are you going to be performing there?
No, I am actually. I'm making my transition to moving there, so this will be my first visit to the ATL, and just to start getting things together for myself. I do have family there, relatives as well. So I don't know any of you in person. So I don't know my nerves got bad when it was time to talk for a second, but I don't know the brother. I just got a mental block, but he's the King Simon.
Yes,
like
yes.
I know everybody from online. You feel
oh,
me?
Oh, okay. By watching and everything.
Exactly. Yeah.
No
so
doubt.
I won't be spitting yet unless the opportunity arrives for me to play or a sing or rap or whatever the case may be.
Okay. Well, when you see me, holler at me, man. We're going to make some things happen.
I love this. This is beautiful because it's really clear to me. Like, so I wanted to be there for the Black Magic 363 celebration for the Holy Ghost 3.
Yeah, that was
and
lit.
So I ended up writing that night. I couldn't. I actually
Okay.
could have, but it didn't work out for me. I put it that way.
Okay.
So I was just there in spirit. And so I wrote that night. I just went in on one of Brother Rich's beats.
Dope.
From that album. And I just started writing and just paying homage to all of you, including Mama Pill, KT, the Arts Degree.
Dope.
You know, everybody. Like, because the inspiration that you all been giving me has been phenomenal in helping me to be really focused of how I'm moving forward in this next part of my life and what I have to offer, you know.
Honors, we appreciate that. And we look forward to linking up with you and assisting you on your creative journey moving forward. Yes, indeed.
I would like to also speak a little bit about Kanye because
okay.
I've been appreciating him from the very jump in ways that I haven't heard people speak on until I heard you speak and Akiba Lan speak.
Oh,
and a few other people here more recently. But from the get-go, I found that it's a lot of parallels with him and I. The difference, it's a lot of differences, of course, as well. But I'm also a producer who produced first and then started writing.
Right.
Started spitting. And I'm also very passionate as well. You know, a lot of heart like him, all of those type of things, very talented, really touch the heart and souls of the people, all of those things. And then also, I also wasn't sure of how my words came across because of the weird ass English language. So I would be passionate like him, but not able to be heard because I didn't stop and study. And I feel like he didn't have the opportunity to really look into how to communicate, more so communicating from a place of heart, but mostly not being heard because of this weird world that we live in the weird English language. And so when people were, you know, like he was the big joke and everything, he wasn't to me because I could hear what he meant so much of the time. Not that I agree with 100% of what he said, of course, but a lot of where he comes from, I really feel like he's not heard properly. And I feel like it's really important to give empathy to our celebrities
right.
who have not been able to know themselves on the level that's necessary for them to move in a way that is not harmful to
right.
themselves, you know, in the words that they say. So I just, you know, I always shout him out because he brings it so much musically. He really touches the people, else we wouldn't be talking about him. Like, you
That's
know what
right.
I mean? It's,
That's right.
It's like he got a lot to say. And it's kind of ironic to me because as a jazz musician, I've been completely like separated from the world in so many ways. It's like a separate world, especially the type of jazz, like the kind that you can't learn in school, the type that I learned. Roy Hargrove or McCoy Tyner, you
yes,
know,
the legends.
John Coltrane. That's where I come from. It's that same type of lineage and that same type of sound, not really the Kenny G sound, which is really the Grover Washington sound. I didn't come from that commercial place. I came from that more that raw acoustic music place. So it wasn't a
right.
place for me to express myself to get the type of notoriety that I see a lot of our youth getting now, I'm glad to say. So it was kind of frustrating initially for me, but now it's really clear that, okay, I had this unique opportunity to sit back, like kind of drop out of all of it. I walked away from a lot of stuff for a long time just to study and to get to this place that I'm at right now. And the excitement that I have about moving to the ATL is just like on a whole nother level, because I know that's my home. I'm so Southern, even though I'm Bay Area, I'm way Bay. Like, you know, I'm from a musical legacy from the Bay Area. But I just, you know, I'll wrap it up by saying that Kanye is a leader. And although him and other people from his generation hasn't led our youth in ways that we know are healthy, it wasn't his responsibility to do that in the first place. He's an artist. It was his
responsibility. He raised the adults. Those adults have children. When you think about Chicago, right? Chief Keef's mama and them was listening to Kanye and Common and all of them. They was responsible for civilizing the savages of his generation and whatnot. But when he was making music, he did touch the younger generation. Henceforth, why he has the loyalty of some of the quote unquote relevant younger artists. There's thousands upon thousands of younger artists. I'm talking about the relevant ones who are still artists. Not rappers. We don't care about the rappers. You know what I'm saying? No disrespect to them, but rappers are too common to really, you know, we are focused more on the artists. So from your perspective, before we leave, I want to know, misfit or blurred in your eyes for Kanye? Is he a misfit? Is he considered to be a black nerd?
I would say misfit. If I had to choose, I really feel like it's both and. But if I had to choose, I would say misfit, because to me, he doesn't represent a real nerd. Because like I grew up in the Bay Area, like I said, Silicon Valley, all those cats, a lot of those cats, jazz musicians from the Bay Area, my generation and younger, those are nerds.
Those are the nerds.
They have no swag. They have no swag. Now, when we put the B on there, we say blurred, then that's going to put some swag in.
They give it a little bit. They can give him a shag. You know how they got the thing in the back? Dudes be rocking the little shag in the back. That's what that when you put the B on the nerd, that's the shag. But it's still Carlton. It's still giving Carlton Banks. Still giving the two left feet from Carlton Banks.
See, he don't give that. From my perspective, he don't. That's why I have to say misfit for him.
Can I play advocate?
Yes.
All right. So the misfits and the nerds can't be one. I'm gonna separate them. I'm gonna add that preface just for the conversation, for the perspective. If you're one, you can't be the other. You can go from one to the other, but you can't be both. I'd say I'm going to abstract out from the words blurs and misfits, and I'm going to use the word genius. The genius never sold his ideas. The genius owns his masters to this day. The reason why I apply that to the misfits, and I'll go back to the fighting game community, the guy I brought up, Yipes, the fighting game community only even existed, and all the developers only make games and hire the people in the fighting game community because of him. The other communities that didn't have someone like him, they had a nerd, for example, had all kinds of sexual allegations and all kinds of weird stuff coming around. The cancel culture was heavy. So what I've learned is what follows nerds tends to be the cancel culture, but also it's just tricky because that's how they also bully the misfits. So it kind of is collapsing in on itself. And what I'm seeing is nerds are transitioning into misfits. So for most of Kanye's career, after his mother dies, specifically, I think he kind of fell off of being different and didn't know how to be himself anymore. And the way I define a nerd is that there's someone who doesn't know how to be themselves, so they have to be like the group, the nerds. It's like Black Lives Matter and the LGBT. It's the concept. Whereas the misfits, they're identifying with themselves. They don't need a reference. They don't need Moors. They don't need Christians. They don't need Muslims. They don't need Islam. I am who I am. I'm not a scientist. I'm someone who
learns from scientists as myself. And I love Kanye. Graduation is one of my favorite albums. But where I say he differentiates from the Misfits is that he's still a part of the system. The reason why I say that is because he's freeing himself now, but right. I don't think he's free yet. Right. The reason why I say that is because he would be in this conversation right here with us.
You think so?
I know so. The Misfits are coming. They coming to take back what's theirs because the knowledge don't belong to nobody else. They don't even belong to us.
So when he speaks, rather than not just speak, but when he demonstrates, is he speaking to the Misfits out there? Is he getting them invigorated, or is he striking out to the Blurs?
The Blurs. When he went on Lex Freeman's thing saying he wanted to get the scientists and engineers, he ain't never followed through.
Yeah.
See, in my position, I'm coming up. So, I mean, I still shouldn't do that, but I have a little more leg room forever. And that's right. Not fair. Let me say that. That's not fair, but that's where we are. He got all the money in the position. If he really wanted to build that city, I'm one of the top engineers. I'm one of the top. The only reason why people don't know me is because I'm black. That's just the truth. So why didn't he go on a podcast about scientists, engineers, and talk about the Israelites to engineers? We don't care about that. We already went through that. We already, you know, had our moment and said either it's true or it's not. We chose our side. So to bring up a conversation that we already had, it's like bringing up slavery or what do you bring to the table? We don't care about that. We already dealt with that. So I just don't feel Kanye's follow through strong. He talks a good game, but he ain't going to build a city. He wants to. He says, I got this dream and this idea and I want to architect it. And I'm not even asking for credentials because I think credentials come and go. Where's the city? Where's the invitation to all of the black engineers? I know many from Kanye West. Because that's who's going to build the city. Nobody else got the handcraft to do it.
Right. I would play advocate and say that would come along after he got himself back together by going to what he knows the most, and that is that music and that entertainment. And I would also end it by asking you another question. Candace Owens, a.k.a. Red Pill Black, Misfit or Blurred?
She just changed the game. She got canceled for standing up against the bullshit.
She's a prop. She's black media's biggest threat now.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to completely disrupt the game. She's an independent free agent. They're gonna give her a bag, right? She's gonna get a big bag, but she is a direct threat to the Chatty Patties, the all of that Joe Button, Charlamagne, not really telling the news, like not being real journalism. She's a disruptor in the room. And as you can see with her PR campaign, her whole campaign was about doing what? Coming back into the center of Black America, because Black America is moving into a Trump era. So she's going to be a loud voice. She's going to be maybe the loudest voice when Black America is going to be forced to be into Trump's new America. If everything goes down the way that they're planning it. But nerd or disruptor, what do you say?
I say both and again. Like, I really do. I really feel like it's a both and with her, and really... In fairness, I don't know a whole bunch about her, but I did hear that the Joe Budden podcast, and I really could appreciate her realness. I was actually surprised. I was surprised because a lot of the points she made, I saw them as facts. I saw that her approach was more, I guess, blurred, but you know what? I'm not going to even try to answer that blurred, or I don't know. I'm going to just say I'm still learning about that. I'm still learning what both of those terms even mean. So
right.
I'm going to stop right there and just say thank you for this opportunity. I'm really glad to meet everybody.
Likewise. I look forward to seeing you and meeting you in the person very soon. Safe travels, and we'll see you in the 8.
Appreciate it.
Yes, indeed. So yeah, family, we're about to wrap it up. You know, I'm talking about we had a beautiful build, and me and Alkibalon, we have a very, 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 very powerful presentation that we're gonna be delivering to you guys on April the 7th. So much is going on. We don't want to rush this greatness, you know what I mean? We want to deliver y'all a clear W. It's been a while since me and Alkibalon came together and delivered a classic. As a matter of fact, let me see something. I might have, let me check, let me double check on my Gumroad. I know that we had a request to put together a bundle pack by some of our supporters and whatnot. Let me check that out. We did put a bundle pack together that had all of the lectures that we put together. So let me check. Let me check. Yeah, let me drop my Gumroad in here for the family that's in the building. Go and check out the Gumroad, and you will have access to the bundle that we have. We have a bundle pack of four lectures that me and Alkibalon did. And if you want to basically catch up to, remember, we talking about prophecy. And once again, I'm not allowed to beat on my chest like that. I gotta let somebody else do it. But we basically have prophecy that we caught over the past few years and whatnot. We were laying some things out, and this information is man, like if you haven't seen it, if you haven't tapped into the lectures that we've done, please follow what it is that we're doing. Please tap in. Please understand that this brother Alkibalon was given pure prophecy from 2022 to 23, laying shit out scientifically, letting you know what it was coming and what was on the horizon. Henceforth, while everything that's going on now, it is of no surprise. It's not catching me by surprise. It's not, you know, I don't have any you know, it is what it is. It's giving what it's supposed to give, because the brother already laid it out. So shout out to him being able to forecast, being able to peer into the future, being able to lift the veils and whatnot. And man, yes, yeah, Soulmatic and the Illest to bring the static. That was a classic. That was a classic. I encourage everybody to go ahead and go do a deep dive on this brother's previous work, because you will see a prophet in your midst. Okay? There's no, you know, men lie, women lie. The information don't. You know what I'm talking about? Men lie, women lie. The information stands on its own, because if he says something in 2023 that took place in 2024, how did he know? How did he know if he's not doing the research, if he's not aligned? So with that being said, I encourage y'all to be in the building with us on April 7th, the day before the solar eclipse. We're gonna charge this thing up the way that it's supposed to be charged. Like I said, you know, and when it comes to this music and this entertainment thing, the stars that are in the sky, as you can see, the stars are falling out of the sky. And we're gonna be here as observers to, you know, just show you, just to help to translate what it is that's taking place, so we know what we're seeing versus this propaganda that they're trying to sell us through mainstream media and these controlled agents that are out here claiming to be new media. So yeah, you want to leave us with anything? I'll keep it on.
Yeah, I just want to encourage the family again, and shout out to the family that tapped in. You know, because again, for this live, I definitely wanted to get a family a platform, because we don't get to see a lot of our geniuses and hear a lot of from our geniuses, you know, talk, you know, a good game and, you know, speak facts. So I appreciate the family who stepped up and, you know, came up and you know, did their due diligence. You know, for the family, again, we got a monumental lecture coming up April 7th, the day before the solar eclipse. Prior to that, we kicking off the God Body Challenge, which is a 3 to 5 day water fast, coconut water fast. So, you know, let's engage, you know, let's get the body right. Again, in the lecture itself, I'm going to speak candidly about the sun and the activity that's going on predicated on what we need to do in the form of a demonstration in real time and how to acquiesce to this information coming through. You know, tickets are in the bio, me and Reds. Yeah, again, just another monumental build tonight. I appreciate the family for tapping in. Lecture is going to be April 7th, again, the day before the solar eclipse. So with that, I'm going to land a plane there.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. With that being said, somebody asked for the Cash App. Yes, here you go. Richfield 44 and Alkibalon 44. You know what I'm talking about? Your support is appreciated and your tips are definitely duly noted. The strong end is coming in. For everybody that's out there, be safe, stay dangerous, stay focused. Let's continue to do our due diligence and study. Let's also do our due diligence and create for all of my creators out there. Please do not stop creating. Please do not put your paintbrush and your tablet and your pencil and your pen and your microphone down. This is a precarious times that we're in. There's nothing to do but create. Okay? Just create and be great. With that being said, we will see you Melanin Mondays. I'm going to have something properly prepared for you guys. A nice little succulent feast of information or whatnot. So with that being said, love and light to the family. Oh, yeah. We got some new drip. We got some new drip in the building. The Kings County, the merch is here. You know, spring is here. So we're going to be popping out. We did a taping yesterday with a good sister by the name of DJ Skywalker. So the music rollout is here. The music rollout is here. There's a project coming on 420. There's a project coming on 420. For the sister who's coming into town, you are right on time, because we're gonna be doing something at the same place the brother Rich did his album release on 420. We're gonna be bringing y'all the Twin Pillars, 48 Pillars of Power. Look out for it. The time is now. The countdown is here. We got two videos coming for Money and Power and First Person Shooter. So yeah, look out for that, man. We working. You know what I'm saying? I can't stress it enough. We are working. It never stops. And spring is here. So all of that hibernation that we've been doing, you feel me? Y'all think that we was outside in the winter? No, we was hibernating. We were, you know, we was out the way. So it's really time to pop out. So look out for us. We coming. You dig? And with that being said, love and light to the family. Stay dangerous, y'all. Peace.